Let's strongman this a little bit more. For some people, lactate is still, a bad byproduct of whatever's going on inside your cells. Can you explain why and how lactate is a fuel and such an important one at that in the human body when it comes to, especially when we start talking about exercise and endurance performance?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So yeah, absolutely. Lactate is a great fuel for the body. And this is something that we have learned a lot from, my colleague, mentor, and great friend, George Brooks from the University of California, Berkeley, and pretty much everything we know about lactate. He's been for 50 years working into this, right? So we as physiologists working with athletes or people working now in the area of metabolism applied to many diseases, we owe a lot to his work of 50 years. So we know that lactate is probably the preferred fuel for cells. For example, Dr. Brooks has shown that patients with a TBI, traumatic brain injury, they prefer to use the brain, their injured brains, they heal better with lactate versus glucose. Mm-hmm. And lactate, it's highly readily utilized by almost every cell in the body. It's a great fuel. So when it comes to exercise, lactate is the mandatory byproduct of glucose utilization, of glycolysis, mm-hmm. right? So every time you use glucose, you're going to produce lactate. That glucose, the ultimate step in glucose is pyruvate that has only two choices, either enter the mitochondria or be reduced to lactate. So when there's a high glycolytic flux, pyruvate cannot be oxidized in the mitochondria very well. So there's higher reduction of pyruvate to lactate. This is what happens during high intensity exercise. Mm-hmm. So that lactate, not the lactate per se, but the hydrogen ions associated to lactate, they decrease the pH in the muscle, like what happens in cancer. They decrease the pH in the tumor microenvironment, which is very acidic, and in the muscle is the same. So that those hydrogen ions, they interfere with the muscle contractile force and also with the velocity. I'm not saying necessarily that this is the result of fatigue, because fatigue is a very complex field and we don't know about fatigue. There's the central fatigue and the central nervous system fatigue, right? And possibly lactate as a signaling molecule is involved with that. But we know that if you accumulate too much lactate in your muscles, and again, not the lactate, but the hydrogen ions are going to have an impact on your muscle contraction. Then we know also lactate, if you accumulate it and you don't get rid of it, eventually it's going to shut down glycolysis. So therefore, yeah, it's going to shut down that high intensity. Is that a protective effect? Maybe, but something that we still don't understand completely. But we know that those athletes were very well, and we know, I'm sorry, that lactate is mainly produced in the glycolytic fibers, the type 2 or fast twitch muscle fibers, right? So athletes who have a very good mitochondrial function, they oxidize the lactate, they shuttle it to the slow twitch muscle fibers. And in the mitochondria, the slow twitch muscle fibers, that lactate is converted to energy, or even in the cytosol back to pyruvate and enter the Krebs cycle. So if you don't have a good mitochondrial function, you're going to, that lactate is going to accumulate and you're going to have to release it to the bloodstream. And once it's in the bloodstream, it's utilized by almost every cell in the body as a substrate, like the heart, like the brain. The heart is an amazing utilizer of lactate, and the brain as well, kidneys also. But the idea is that if you have a very good mitochondrial function, you can use it as a fuel within your muscles instead of, the heart using it as a fuel, your muscles can use it as a fuel. So this is part of that mitochondrial function and metabolic efficiency.
That's really, really interesting. One thing I wanted to clarify with you, you were saying that the type 1 fibers preferentially oxidate, or the mitochondria are preferentially going to use free fatty acids. And then you also said that glycolysis obviously is going to use glucose, glycogen, and break this down to generate some ATP. Is there a significant amount of glucose that is used directly by the mitochondria itself, or is it neglectable?
No, the mitochondria, yeah, they can use a lot of glucose as well under fully aerobic conditions. So you can, that glucose through glycolysis is converted to pyruvate, and that pyruvate enters the mitochondria. You know, it's oxidized to acetyl-CoA and then enters the Krebs cycle, right, for energy, for ATP production. That pyruvate enters very well. The problem is pyruvate needs to be oxidized to acetyl-CoA through PDH, pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. And it, sometimes, to put it in more layman's terms, it's a little bit slow. It might act as a fuse. So if you have a lot of a very high glucose influx, that PDH might not work very well. So pyruvate might not be enter the mitochondria very well and be reduced to lactate. But under resting conditions, that's what I mentioned earlier. Under resting conditions, about 80% of the carbohydrates, they have to be oxidized in the skeletal muscle and mainly the mitochondria through pyruvate. Right.
Okay.
But under high glycolytic flux, like in high intensity exercises, there's not much time. And also it's not very efficient because you can produce ATP in the cytosol by reducing it to lactate. And furthermore, under high glycolytic flux, deplete NAD, and you need to regenerate it. And the only way to regenerate NAD is to reduce pyruvate to lactate for the continuation of glycolysis. It's a little tricky, complicated, but that's how we humans, bioenergetics, supposed to work, I guess.
Exactly. It's all tied together. Another link that I thought I understood from one of Brooks's papers is the link between lactate as a signaling molecule and free fatty acid availability and oxidation. Can you talk to that a little bit?
So we know very well through the work from Brooks that lactate is a signaling molecule or a lact hormone, right? Lactate is and now one of the things, we have moved this into areas like cancer. So in cancer, we have proven for the first time that lactate is an onco metabolite. And we published that 2 years ago, where we shown that lactate regulates the genetic expression of all the major genes involved in breast cancer. We published that, and now we have finalized new studies with more cancer cell lines of breast, like triple negative, and then other cell lines like lung cancer, both non-small cell and small cell lung cancer, and we see the same results. And in fact, if we block, because we're blocking it also with genetic engineering, like silencing lactate production, then cancer stops. So lactate is a big signaling molecule in cancer, and it's very possible it's a big signaling molecule in many other processes. Relating to the fatty acid oxidation, it is well known that lactate binds to the GRP81. It's a receptor in the adipocytes, and when lactate binds to that receptor, it inhibits lipolysis. So when you have high blood lactate circulating, they're going to be binding to that receptor, so that it's going to be decreasing lipolysis. So therefore, fat oxidation is going to be reduced. In a paper that we have now under review, we have shown that lactate also inhibits the transport of fatty acids directly for the first time. So we have seen that lactate decreases the activity of CPT1 and CPT2, which are key to transport fatty acids into the mitochondria. And this is we're very excited about this finding because we know that lactate has this endocrine, paracrine, and now we see autocrine properties when it comes to fatty acid metabolism as directly in the mitochondria inhibits its transport.
That's really, really interesting. I saw a couple of papers. I was looking at this last week, and maybe I'm completely off base, but there is no link there. But do you know of any interesting links between this lactate parameter and something I read was about, I believe, myoglobin and oxymyoglobin be having a higher affinity for free fatty acids? From what I understood from that was that if myoglobin is bound to oxygen, free fatty acid transport and uptake by the mitochondria is going to be improved. For me, what that means is if there's more oxygen available, so if we think just lower intensities of exercise, then we're going to have an easier time getting that free fatty acid and using it. Is that linked at all? Do you know of?
I'm not familiar with that study, but yeah, it makes sense, right? Okay. When there's a high oxygenation rate, it's just mitochondria likes oxygen, right? So it might ease all the bioenergetics of skeletal muscle, but again, I'm not familiar with that paper. Sorry.
No problem at all. One thing that, and maybe again, my framework is off on this, but one thing I think of is lactate flux. So what I mean by this, or what I understand by this, is what's below the surface. We have maybe blood lactate, which is the manifestation of the excess production of lactate in the blood. But then there's, like you said, all the lactate that is produced, but then that is transported and recycled. Do we have a sense of the, if that's even a term, the recycling capacity of an elite athlete, an elite cyclist, when it comes to lactate itself versus, your everyday person? Can we quantify how much these pro athletes are able to produce, but then recycle as well right away before it actually manifests in the blood itself?
Yeah, so there's already from 1999, the paper with Bergman, Brian Bergman and George Brooks, where they're showing it how all these lactate kinetics, right, about in trained people as they have trained how lactate is oxidized in the mitochondria, and there's a lower rate of appearance in the bloodstream, meaning that it's been more oxidized in the mitochondria. It's been known also that it's counterintuitive, but it's still thought by many that elite athletes or better trained athletes, they produce more lactate. They just recycle it or oxidize it better, so it doesn't escape, right? So when we see a lactate that's in the blood of 3 millimoles of an athlete at a kind of, let's say, 4 millimoles at a high intensity, that athlete is probably producing a lot more lactate at that intensity than a recreational athlete. The difference is that athlete is oxidizing it much better in the mitochondria and is not escaping as much in the blood. So by the time an elite athlete is at exercising at 4 millimoles of lactate in the blood, it's a very high intensity. Mm-hmm. And this is what we see, that not necessarily the same lactate concentration is the same for everybody.
Right.
Similar, but not the same.
on that point, do you see then a difference between, let's say endurance biased athletes, I'm thinking cyclists, long distance runners, and their lactate levels that they might see at any given intensity, and then maybe athletes from still fairly endurance demanding sports, but maybe much shorter in time duration, for example, rowing? Do you see significant differences in the lactate levels that a cyclist and that a rower might attain?
Well, they're two different sports. I mean, not the same because of the distance, right? Mm-hmm. But I worked extensively with rowers with many for many years, and I have also worked with the U.S. rowing team. And I have a huge database with elite world-class rowers, and their lactate clearance capacity is amazing compared to mere mortals. You know, it's at the same level that we see the lactate clearance capacity of through the front cyclists compared to mere mortals, right? This is the same thing we see, you know, like if you get into like a concept machine, right? A famous, you know, the rowing machine, and you see like a rower at 300 watts, a world-class rower, you know, might be under 2 millimoles of lactate, whereas a mere mortal, just for minutes, right? Whereas a mere mortal at that intensity cannot even last maybe 30 seconds, right? And might be producing 11 millimoles, you know? Mm-hmm. So yeah, the lactic clearance capacity of these rowers is extraordinary, both men and women.
Now, when we talk about lactate clearance capacity, once we go above that second threshold, call it maximum lactate steady state or critical power, or that transition point between metabolic homeostasis and the loss of that homeostasis, where does the lactate go when it starts accumulating in the blood to higher and higher levels? Does it go to non-involved muscles to be oxidized? Does it go to the kidneys? Does it go to the liver? Where does it go?
Yeah, exactly. So lactate, the preferred route for lactate is to go and move and be shuttled, as George Brooks discovered, the lactate shuttle hypothesis. That is not a hypothesis anymore, it's a reality. We're talking about 40 years ago, right? But, it's lactate is shuttled from the fast twitch muscle fibers, very glycolytic muscle fibers, to the slow twitch muscle fibers. And again, as we were saying earlier, it's oxidized back to energy. It gets to a point that where that mitochondria, either because that doesn't have the right capacity or simply just cannot oxidize lactate anymore, then there's no other choice than exporting that lactate to the bloodstream. And that's where we see, that maximal lactate steady state is broken, right? If we see that there's like a steady state of lactate, it is possible there's a balance between lactate production and lactate oxidation, right? When we see there's a raise in lactate, in blood lactate after X amount of time at the same power output or intensity or speed, that means that there's a disruption, right, in that balance of oxidation and production.
Mm-hmm. One thing I've been observing quite a bit when I've been doing some step tests with either runners or cyclists, once they push beyond that second threshold, what I start to see, and more in higher trained athletes than others, is using a NEARS device on, for example, the forearm for a runner or the shoulder for a cyclist, I see a pretty strong deoxygenation in the non-involved muscle. My hypothesis is that it might be the lactate that's being shuttled around and that's using up, so to speak, the oxygen that's in those non-involved muscles. Do you have any sense if that might be what's actually happening, or is there another explanation for, strong desaturation of non-involved muscles above second threshold?
No, that's a great, great question and great observation. And there are a few studies on that. So there's I was, in fact, when I was in the 90s, a subject, a guinea pig in one of those studies where I would oxygenation was decreased significantly. And it's probably this redistribution, right? So in those non-exercising muscles, that they're not using much muscle. And again, we're looking at NEARS, which is, again, it penetrates for about a centimeter or so. So most of that blood that we see is more at the skin level, more than the muscle level, right? And we also know that, excuse me, that there's because of catecholamines, a very high intensity is going to lead to catecholamine release, a much higher. And that's a very powerful vasoconstriction, right? So it's very possible that, first there's a vasoconstriction. And also it's very possible there's a redistribution of blood flow from areas that are not needed to areas that are needed, more like inside the skeletal muscle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes
sense. And if I probably, as you have said, very well observation, right, that the elite athletes tend to, you can see this more exacerbated in them than in recreational athletes, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, because they probably are more efficient at redistributing oxygen.
Thanks for listening to this episode. If you would like to support the podcast, please take a few moments to leave a written review and a 5-star rating on Apple Podcasts. If you want to watch this episode again, you can find the full video recording on my YouTube channel. You'll also find hundreds of hours of free content, all my podcasts, my thoughts of the day, structured presentations, and more. So don't wait, go subscribe, and I'll see you in the next episode. Take care.